was alone in the evening. I look outside my window at the shadows in the night. I hear the sound of distant crying, the darkness multiplying, and weary hearts denied.
Hello, and welcome to our show, our third installation of the bouquet series. I'm so excited, always am, to do this show because it's such a passion project. And I'm happy to, you know, chill with you guys, talk about some things that are on my mind, on my chest, get some things off my chest, and, you know, get into the music, get into people who will be telling us their amazing stories on how they've been able to overcome the challenges that have come with COVID. And I'm really excited about that. So with me today, I have my co-host, Chloe. Chloe, say hi to everyone.
Hi, everyone. Hi, Ellie. Thank you so much for having me here. I'm so excited to be doing this with you.
I'm so excited to have you. So I met Chloe. When did I meet you? I think.
Oh, wow. I think probably at the Africa Center.
Yeah. Was it this year?
Yeah, should be this year.
Okay. So Chloe, I met her at the Africa Center and she's doing phenomenal things there, including being an editor of a magazine, which is so, so insane. How is that?
It's actually going really well. And you're, as you know, you're actually on the cover of this month's issue.
Yes.
I'm so excited. We're distributing that to schools, consulates. We're trying to get the word around, trying to get people more hyped for Africans here in Hong Kong.
Yeah. Thank you for all the work that you're doing. And yeah, she did mention that I'm on the cover of this month's magazine or this month's issue. And I'm so, so honored. So thank you, Chloe, for coming through. I thought you'd be the perfect co-host for today. You know, we're going to talk about things like NSARS and, you know, all the craziness that is happening in this world. So thank you so much for coming through.
No problem. Happy to be here.
Yeah. And it's Halloween. Oh my gosh. Yeah. Then, yeah, we should be talking about some of the scary things that are happening in this world. I think that's the ultimate scare. We'll also be having our special guest, who is Emmanuel Ikubese. He's a Nigerian actor, director, producer, philanthropist, and he also holds the Mr. Nigeria 2014 title and the runner-up for Mr. World Nigeria. So yeah, he's doing some incredible things with his Raw project, with NSARS, and you know, so I'm really happy to be talking to Emmanuel today. And of course, we're going to be talking to our inspirational story this month by the Business Plug, except this month it's not a business plug. It's actually a student who happened to be in Wuhan when everything like broke out and the whole world was in a frenzy. And she'll be talking to us today about, you know, how it felt to be there in that moment, the thoughts, the atmosphere, the vibe, the feeling, all of that stuff. And she will also be, you know, telling us how she feels about going back to Wuhan within this year or this, you know, November. So she'll be returning to Wuhan and, you know, just her thoughts, her mind, her energy, being stuck in limbo in Hong Kong for a while and how that has been for her. So that will be Tamira Tembo, an engineering student and an amazing makeup artist who also happens to have done my makeup for the photo shoot for the magazine cover. I love how everything is so intertwined. Yeah, she's an incredible makeup artist. So I'm looking forward to speaking to Tamira. And we'll be, of course, playing some amazing music throughout, including my song at the end, My Tie Act.
Can't wait.
Thank you. And yeah, so that is all leading up to my EP, which I'm releasing in December. I'm so excited. The planning is insane, but, you know, it's all worth it. And last but not least, we'll be talking to Chloe, or Chloe will be heading the topic for this month, and she'll tell you all about that. I don't want to spoil the surprise. So yeah, let us jump into talking to Tamira. And can I have a PC for now? Hello, Tamira, you're on air. How are you?
I'm all right. Thank you, Ellie. How are you?
I'm good. So you're still kind of relaxed in Hong Kong, right? Where you are?
Yes. Amazing.
Yes. I'm glad that I'm still here. Sorry, say again.
I'm saying I'm glad that I'm still here.
Are you? Well, that's interesting. So yes. You're not missing Wuhan at all?
I am. Like, that's kind of like my home now. It's like my second home.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
So Wuhan or Hong Kong?
I would definitely pick Hong Kong because of the opportunities that are here. And it's much easier to work here and stuff like that because people, there's no language barrier here than in Wuhan, if you understand what I mean.
Yes, I do. So are you looking into kind of settling into Hong Kong once you're done in Wuhan?
Who knows? Maybe.
Okay.
It depends on the opportunity, I guess.
Yes, that is fair. So Tam, I'm going to jump into the questions. If that's all right.
Yeah, sure.
All right. So, what are you studying in Wuhan and what made you decide to study all the way there?
I'm studying civil engineering and I decided to pick Wuhan because it was a low-key place. Like, nobody knew about it. People started hearing about it only after the COVID. Now, if you tell somebody in Africa, I'm in Wuhan, they'll be like, the city where the COVID came from.
Yeah.
But otherwise, I picked the city because it's one of the top, it's in the top 10. The city, the university I'm at is like on the top 10 universities for civil engineering.
Mm.
And also, I feel like Wuhan, China gives me or provides me a learning opportunity and exposure to their infrastructure and development.
Yeah. All right. Exactly. So which year are you in currently within your studies?
I'm in my fourth year. This is my last. I'll be graduating next year in June.
Oh, nice. Are you looking forward to that?
It's kind of sad because I feel like I kind of lost 10 months of not being in school because of the COVID. I've been like stuck here, but I'm looking forward to get into the real world.
Yeah.
To work. Yeah.
I see. So what, now that we're speaking about Wuhan and, you know, how it is your second home, I want to know what the atmosphere was like when everything happened in Wuhan. It was like, whoa, that came out of left field for everybody. But I can imagine, especially for the people who were there. So what were your thoughts during that time?
So before everybody else heard about the virus, my uncle called me, my uncle here in Hong Kong, he called me. He's like, I heard there's an outbreak for like the COVID, the virus and everything. And everybody was shocked when I told them, my uncle told me there's like a virus in Wuhan. Everyone was shocked. They kind of thought like it was a joke. And us knowing China and how like it's like one of the big five countries in the world, we thought, the Chinese are probably going to like solve it anytime soon. Like, this is just probably going to last for like a month or something. But then surprisingly, it's been going on till now and it's very weird. But my friends were going through a hard time at the time when... Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay. So my friends were going through a hard time. Thank God I left before the lockdown. The day before I left, they started taking measures. They like checked our temperature every day and stuff like that. And then I left Wuhan, came here, thank God. But then my friends were going through a hard time. Like, it was really tough for them. Being foreigners and being locks, they don't know if they're going to survive it or not and everything.
Yeah.
But then they're okay now. Everything is settled in Wuhan. They even move around without wearing a mask and stuff like that.
Oh, wow.
Everything is way better now.
I see. So when you were in Hong Kong and you realized that, oh my gosh, this is serious.
Yeah.
Did you ever have thoughts like kind of to say, I don't think I'm going to go back to Wuhan. Has that ever crossed your mind?
Yeah, certainly that crossed my mind. I was like, maybe it would be better if I transfer to somewhere else, maybe Hong Kong, or maybe go finish studies in Zambia or something like that. But
Yeah.
then the thought of, I still had the feeling that the Chinese are going to solve it. Like they're probably going to find something somewhere. And
Yeah.
then it was like a pandemic everywhere in the world. And I was like, oh snap, I'm probably not going to go back to Wuhan.
I see. So, how has life been since you're in limbo? You're not in Zambia and you're not in Wuhan. You're kind of waiting it out in Hong Kong. How is that experience like?
Apart from school being difficult because I'm learning online and I'm not around my friends, everything else is okay just apart from that. And also, I need to extend my visa here every maybe after 3 months. And that's
Yes.
a little pressure because I don't know if they'll decide to say, oh, yes, we're going to allow you to extend your visa. Or they'll say, no, we can't allow you. So it's either you go back to Zambia or go back to Wuhan. And the case where they're saying, I can't go back to Wuhan yet because only work visas. And I can't go back to Zambia because it's expensive. So that thought has always been on my mind. I'm like, what's going to happen next? Am I going to be here for another 3 months, or is the immigration going to say no, you need to go back to your country and stuff like that? And the work experience here is amazing. The people here in Hong Kong are amazing. Like, I see how young people like you are making big things. Like, you guys are going, I don't know, massive. It's just amazing how you guys all work together, the African community and stuff like that. It's so nice and inspiring. I
Oh,
kind
thank
of
you.
like feel like I've found myself here. I know what I want to do. Like, I have an idea of what I want to do in my future.
Oh, wow. That's really nice of you. And we're glad that Hong Kong can give you that experience, especially Gavin. He's the most excited to hear that. So we're happy that Hong Kong could give you that experience. So what are you looking forward to the most about going back to Wuhan? You'll be going back soon, I assume.
The food first. I miss the food that side. Not that the food here is different, but it's just nicer that side, so to
What
say.
food? The local food, like the Chinese food.
Like the Chinese food.
Okay.
Yeah, I
Yeah.
don't know the names, so I can't say the names, but I just miss
Yeah.
the food at
Okay.
school.
Yeah.
And
Oh,
also my friends.
so you live in a dorm, in a rest?
I'm living in the university.
And your friends. You mentioned your friends quite often. Are they friend international friends, local friends? Do you speak to them in Chinese? What's the situation?
They are my friends from my country. It was hard for me to make friends with people from other countries. I don't know why, but it was just kind of hard. And all my friends are from my country, they're from Zambia, but I have a local friend, a Chinese friend. She's been like amazing, like a sister to me. We talk every day now that I'm in Hong Kong. We talk every day, we video chat and everything. So I am looking forward to go back and spend time with them because this is my last year. And I don't know if we're going to be friends in the real world. So I'm looking forward to that. And then knowing how the relationship can be built and the whole networking thing.
I see. So you were talking about language barriers earlier. Do you speak Chinese or Mandarin, Putonghua?
I understand Mandarin, but I can't speak it. The constructing part is really hard. Like, if somebody was to talk to me in Mandarin, I would probably pick up a few words and know what they mean. And I would try to respond to them in Mandarin, but it's very hard. It's very, very hard.
I see. Well, A for effort, right? At least you can understand some of it. Well, that's good. And how about Africa? Are there any plans to go back to Africa, or will that be after you graduate?
That's probably going to be after I graduate because I feel like I only need to go there when I have something to add to the country. And like just going there and then life still continues being the same, that's not my plan. So I'm definitely going to go back to Africa when I have something to contribute to my country and to Africa as well.
I see, I see. Well, yeah. Tamira, we wish you the best with everything that is happening. You are doing really well, you know, because even though you're stuck in limbo, you are still, you know, participating with the real world, as we've been putting it today. You're participating, you're going out there, you're meeting people, you're, you know, doing a little bit of makeup. So let's talk about that, the makeup aspect of it. So when did you start doing makeup?
I started doing makeup when I came here to China. I'm the one who doesn't like to ask people, like, can you do this for me? So instead, I was like, let me learn and then maybe make what I love and make money out of it. Do you get it?
Yeah.
So I kind of, like, taught myself. I watch YouTube videos. I watch tutorials on how people do certain things. I'm like, oh, I'm going to try it on myself and then take pictures after that and see what people think about it. Mm-hmm. So I started doing that, like, a year ago. And my friends were like, no, you know what? Just keep doing it. You're doing good. Just keep doing it. My friends would come and support me. They'll ask me to do their makeup and they give me money. And after I came here, you were the first person that was like, oh, I need you to do my makeup. How much are you going to charge me? I was like, whoa, wow, that's incredible. Like, I didn't know I would make money out of this. Like, I thought I know I'm good, but I didn't know I would make money out of it. And it's really been good. It's really been nice. Like, I just love doing what I love and making money out of it.
Yeah.
That's the plan. Yeah.
Oh, that's good. That's interesting to hear. You do deserve your coins because you're great at it. So thank you much for not only doing the makeup, but for also, you know, just being a wonderful person and being a great addition to the community here in Hong Kong.
Thank you.
Okay, Tamira, you take care. I will see you soon, I hope.
You, yes.
Okay. Oh, yeah, we got a boat party coming up. I'll probably see you then.
Oh, yeah, see you there.
Okay.
That'll be amazing.
Okay, until next time, cheers.
Bye.
Bye. That was, of course, Tamira, the student who's in Wuhan at the moment. Oh, who's in Hong Kong at the moment because of what happened in Wuhan, as you heard. And so now we're going to go over to a jam by a South African artist, Lady Zamar, and this is called Daydreaming.
Show no remorse, I need a change, I'm drowning.
You are still tuned into the bouquet series, and if you have any comments, if you want to have a chat, you can actually send me a private message on Instagram. That will be at Ellie_Zylo. Again, I'll say at Ellie_ZAELO. And we can chat, we can talk about the show or what you want to hear, or your favorite parts, you know, anything you want to talk about. I'm very open and very willing to talk to you guys about it. So yeah, you're still tuned into the bouquet series. We just listened to Lady Zamar's Daydreaming. I absolutely love that song. Just like, I don't know, something about it makes me feel like I'm in a music video. Like, do you have those songs sometimes? You listen to them and then you picture yourself being in a music video?
Definitely.
You do?
Yeah.
Okay, good. I'm glad I'm not the only one, because that song definitely makes me feel like that. Just kind of like daydream. Yeah. Okay. So, yeah, we're going to move on to our special segment with our special celebrity guest. Our next guest is widely known for his role as Femi on MTV Sugar, a show that is based on dismantling as well as educating the youth on issues around HIV and AIDS. It pulls in a viewership of around 100 million people worldwide. He also holds the titles of Mr. Nigeria 2014 and Mr. World Africa. He is also an activist around the issues of domestic violence and the End SARS movement. It is an honor to have Mr. Emmanuel Ikubese on the show. And we previously recorded the conversation via Zoom, and we will be rolling it now.
Now we're going to get into the deeper kind of off-screen things.
Okay.
To talk about your philanthropy. I know that you have the organization RAW, which is Respect Award. Can you tell us why that particular kind of choice of
yeah.
why respecting a woman?
Okay. Growing up in university, I experienced quite a number of domestic violence situations, and a couple of them I tried to get involved, tried to help, and of course I did it the wrong way, which got me into trouble. But I got to realize that domestic violence is something way deeper than just beating up a woman, hitting a woman. I believe it starts from a way deeper space. It starts from emotional violence, psychological violence, mental violence, before it actually gets physical. And a lot of this phase is actually way more dangerous than the physical aspect of domestic violence. It's like when someone gets into an accident and they realize that they don't have any bodily wounds, but you go into the hospital and you go into a scan and they're like, wow, you have some cuts inside. Yeah. It's way dangerous than actually the ones on the outside, because the ones on the outside can be treated and you're fine. But internal body wounds or internal things are just deeper to heal than something on the outside. So I realized this is one of the major issues with domestic violence. And I realized we've been handling domestic violence from a very wrong perspective. We've seen a lot of women come out to say, we need to stop domestic violence. But the truth is, the perpetrators are just being quiet. I mean, we know there are situations where women beat men, you know, but I mean, these are really very, you know, very little, you know, the percentage is very little compared to that of, compared to the other side of it. Mm-hmm. And I mean, men are the perpetrators of domestic violence. And if women keep on, the victims are always crying out, it's high time the men begin to support. And, you know, because I there's a saying that silence is, it's approval, you know, when you're silent, when men are silent, it's almost like you're approving of what is going on with other men hitting women. And I think it's wrong, because for me, I see it as a woman represents your mother. A woman represents your mom. A woman represents your sister. You know, the things you would not do as a man. Imagine someone hitting your mom. You go crazy. Imagine someone hitting your family, your sister. That just drives you nuts. So imagine you doing this to somebody else's potential mother, if she's not a mom at that time, or a mother who has kids, or someone else's sister. I mean, if we as men begin to see this thing as it literally affects us in one way or the other, then we need to begin to learn our voices. And then for me, Raw, what Raw represents is something way deeper than actually what it is, because domestic violence has gone in so deep into our society. And with Raw, what we decided to do is, you know what, while we are dealing with these deep issues with a lot of our activations, we want to also take these activations down to the next generation. Okay, so we have programs such as Groom Boys, you know, where we are basically teaching the younger generations, from the boy child to the girl child, on what to expect in situations like this. As a girl child, you need to know that once a guy hits you from the very first time, you need to see these early signs and know that this is not where I want to be. Yeah. You know, from a boy child perspective, a lot of them don't know any better, because unfortunately our society grooms women way better than we groom men. Mm-hmm. You know, women are taught at a very early stage that, you know, you need to learn how to cook for your husband, you need to dress nicely, you need to sit down nicely, blah, 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 you know, all of these amazing nice things which they take up and become really great people in the society. But the men in our society are really not brought up in that manner. They're just allowed to be boys, play rough, play with cars, go to school, and just, hey, all you need to do as a man is provide for the family. Mm-hmm. You understand? And they are not taught these simple things as when you're provoked, because we know that women sometimes can be very provocative, because a woman is not physically strong, but they have power in their mouths. I mean, a woman can finish you from just the things she says to you, and you think about your life and you'd be like, oh my goodness, you know? But it's how do men emotionally handle these things, and how do they learn to handle these things, so that when it gets to that place, you know that violence or physical abuse is not the next thing. You know, just step out of that situation with that. You just understand that this is who these people are. You understand? And using your strength, your physical strength in that situation would not solve the matter. You only make it become worse. Because what men do is use that physical strength to tame the woman to the point where she can no longer speak. And that's the whole idea, you know, and that is not nice, you know, and this is why we've seen a lot of situations where it has even led to death, and, you know, it's just a whole lot. So, but with the Raw initiative, what we're doing is letting young boys know that, hey, you should respect a woman. Begin to see women as your mom, like the way you see your mom. See a woman the way you see your mom, the way you see your sister. The same way you would not want any hurts to come on your sister or your mom is the same way you see another woman as your as a potential mom and someone else's sister. I believe if we begin to put that orientation in the mindset of our younger generation, we will begin to have a society that respects women.
True. And, you know, just also just seeing women as just human beings. If you wouldn't want to be harmed, why would you want to harm another?
Exactly.
Really commendable that you're doing this for boys at a young age, because like you're saying, the grooming phase it basically forms majority of a person's personality. It's so hard to outgrow things that you've known since the time you were young. Mm-hmm. You know, to expect grown men to unlearn certain things, it takes a while. So thank you for the input that you are putting forth.
Thank you.
It's really appreciated in this day and this time and day, you know, it's really appreciated. Yeah.
Thank you.
So story, story heavy, yeah, oh, ah. for the small things. So. Forget about the big things. So, say we can talk about the small things. So, yeah.
Was Rara by Tekno. That song highlights some of the oppression that some of the that Nigerian citizens are experiencing in Nigeria due to the government, due to greed and all of this. And yeah, it's such a beautiful song. I wish I could understand all of it, but I'm not fluent in Pidgin English, but the vibe is cool. I like it. Yep. And so now we're going to move on to, you know, our girl over here, Chloe.
Hi.
Yes, tell us what's on your mind.
Well, as you know, recently Hong Kong has relaxed some restrictions allowing live performances in Hong Kong.
Yeah.
And we're all pretty excited for that.
Yeah.
So, I am really excited that live music is making a comeback in the city. Because, you know, whenever I think about Hong Kong, I immediately picture many of my favorite spots in Central where I hear crazy talented musicians playing some of my favorite songs.
Yeah.
So, you know, Hong Kong isn't Hong Kong without our street performers, our live bands and in bars and restos, and our pianists who make our dining experience extra fancy.
Yeah, that's true.
So, and I think that we can all agree with that because after a long day in the office or at school, music is the one thing that we all retreat to for comfort.
Mm.
I highly respect musicians and artists because I don't think any of us would be sane during tough times. I think it's always the arts that makes us feel calm and safe, kind of like a little vacation from reality.
Yeah, yeah.
So, our fellow musicians, as we all know, are one of the hardest hit groups here in the city, considering a lot of their gigs were cancelled even way before the pandemic,
as
Hong Kong was going through a series of protests.
Mm.
So, I read that some resorted to taking up food delivery jobs to pay for bills or depend on welfare, but their income is way lower than what they earn as musicians.
Mm.
And I read many stories of musicians having to resort to online means to generate income by hosting virtual shows and rehearsing their gigs in the event that the city may allow large-scale performances. It was definitely no easy task for them.
Yeah.
And they all agree that nothing can replace live music. I think.
True.
Yeah, that's true. So to quote Joshua Chan, one of the founders of the Tone Festival, the saying goes that you experience music with your skin. It's about the vibration, the sublow. It's about being there in the moment. And at a gig, the audience is part of the performance.
Yeah.
Yes. And it's always a two-way or multi-way interaction. While on the internet, the interaction is definitely limited. It's very two-dimensional.
Mm-hmm.
As we are not in the presence of the music. And, you know, we enjoy life through our five senses.
Yeah.
When you're at a concert, you hear the music, you feel the vibration through the walls, through the floors, through your feet, and that makes you go dance.
Yeah.
Yeah, I love that feeling, but then that's definitely what is missing out. Mm. And with the live performances making a comeback in Hong Kong, I know everyone is definitely excited to experience that all over again. And I heard that you will be performing tonight.
Yes, I will be. I'll be at Dragonfly in Central. So about the live music, it's really, really been something else, because a lot of my friends are musicians and I've just been seeing how everything has been taking its toll on people. I'm lucky in a sense that I have a day job, so it wasn't that drastic, but to see other people, you know, dive in to that plummet that felt like it would never end, and then there was a little bit of a relief, I think around August things was coming before this recent wave. There was a point in time where live music was open for like 2 weeks, right?
Yes.
And then it was just back to normal, you know, back to nothing really. And I'm so happy. I know that a lot of musicians are celebrating. You know, live music started yesterday in Hong Kong, and tonight is going to be a party. I'm excited for that. But yeah, all in all, I feel like the pros to live music being back is obviously people have their jobs now. Everybody can go out and celebrate. Things can be, you know, zibbity doodah. It can be fun. But at the same time, I'm kind of like really crossing my fingers, hoping that this won't result to, you know, a catastrophe in a sense of going back to what we went to from August till now, where people are excited about the live music coming back and then all of a sudden it gets taken away like in an instant. And that's just my concern at the moment. But you know, let's keep it positive. Let's hope for the best and be optimistic. And you know, hopefully it can last throughout to all the way to New Year's Eve. I would hate to have a New Year's Eve with no live music. Just imagine. Oh my gosh. What do you do with yourself? Where do you go? Like, what are you supposed to do? Watch movies during the countdown? That's insane. So I'm hoping that we could have live music for New Year's Eve.
Yeah, I think. Cross fingers.
Yes. All right, ladies and gentlemen, as Chloe said, I will be at Dragonfly now. So do come through. It ends at 11, so you still have time to come through to Dragonfly. And yeah, we'll be playing all of your favorite tunes from R&B to rock to whatever it is that floats your boat. It will definitely be there with this incredible band at Dragonfly on Hollywood Road. So yeah, that concludes our show for today. Thank you so much to everybody who is, you know, who's listening. Thank you to Chloe for being such an amazing co-host today.
Happy to be here.
Yes, happy to have you. And thank you to the Big G always for the opportunity. Thank you, man. We are so grateful. Thank you to the show producer, Ria Mashihu, all the way in South Africa. And to close off the show, we're going to play my jam, which is called No Entry.
Asking them where I've been, telling you struggling. Then you list your regrets, hoping we were connected, but you seem to forget. The times when I held you down, left me on a high note, because you come back around.